Dear auditors and friends, welcome back to the part two of this very special training about the certificate of financial statements. My name is Gheorghe Bancos and I will be your host for this training. This part is about the personal cost. We will cover the main eligibility criteria and the audit procedures. It is a lot to cover, but okay, this is just a short summary. We have about 45 pages with us. So here you can see the main points that we'll talk about. So workforce contracts, natural persons, time recording, hourly rates, productive hours, double ceiling, consistency. You'll see what consistency do I mean, and also some bonus things specially for you for today. It's about 45 slides, so I would expect this will take at least half an hour or something. So I would invite you to pause the video from time to time so that you can read in peace the slides and then listen what I'm saying, because I will go quite quickly on them and let's say I will try sometimes to mention some things which are not on the slides or some things which are not so obvious, let's say. So the first thing that you need to master is to, you know, to be comfortable, you know, where you classify the work contracts, because you see, depending on the answers to these questions on the slide, like, you know, if it's an employment contract or not, if it's with a person or with a company, you know, or, you know, where the people work, you know, or how many contracts they have, then based on this, let's say the contract may be eligible under personal cost, under subcontracting, or other under other goods and services, you know. So this is a very important topic. So what you can claim in personal cost? So of course you can claim the employees, you know, but you can also claim natural persons, provided that they work under similar conditions to that of an employee, that the results of work belong to the beneficiary, and that the costs are not significantly different for those of an employee. In 2017, it was a slight change in the wording to allow to be eligible for the COCOCO and the COCOPRO contracts from Italy and, okay, similar contracts in other countries. Okay, also other case that it can be claimed under personal cost, but it must be set in Annex 1. It's employees of a third party seconded to the beneficiary. So now let's see what you cannot claim. So of course, if some of these conditions is not fulfilled, then okay, it's not personal cost, it's something else. It's other goods and services or subcontracting. So you may have issues with the hourly rates, or where are the people working, or that the conditions are not similar, or the contracts it's, you see, with a company, not with a natural person. Also, if they were very independent, more like a subcontractor, and they are paid for deliverables rather than working time, again, it's not for personal cost, but it is for the other two cost categories. Now let's switch to the next point, the time records. First, let's bear in mind which are the main issues which may appear, you know, with the time records. So you may find inconsistencies with the human resource records and the time records. Like here we are talking about the holidays, work-related travel, and sick leave. Then it may be that the minimum requirements for timesheets are not fulfilled, or you may have issues with the double ceiling. On the next slides, we will explain what it is, this double ceiling, about. Okay, it's exactly the next slide. So this is very important, because there are two double ceiling. One, it's on the hours. You see that the total number of hours declared in EU and Euratom grants for a person for a year should not be higher than the number of annual productive time hours used for the calculation of the hourly rate. And then it's the same check, but on the cost, not on the hours. In the CFS procedure, this is not, you know, directly mentioned that you need to check it, but it's mentioned that basically the costs are complying, you know, with certain articles. And if you read these articles in the grant agreement, you see that it also you know, it's also about this the double sealing. So just be sure that you verify this thing, because it may have serious impact for your CFS audit. Okay, so which are the minimum requirements for the timesheet? So you see, you need to have in the timesheets the title and number of the action, the beneficiary full name, date and signature of the person working for the action, the number of hours worked for the action, the supervisor full name and signature, and the reference to the action task and work packages. And in addition, the timesheets, they need to match with the records of annual leave, sick leave, other leaves and work-related travel. So there are two options how to keep time records. You have the timesheets and you have also this declaration of exclusive work, which can be used, you know, if you have at least covered inside one calendar month and up to one period, and you can only use one declaration per period. So if you use the declaration for a couple of months and you still have time in your period, then to timesheets if you don't want to lose the hours as beneficiary when you declare the cost. This is an example. How does it look like? The declaration of exclusive work for the action is more or less like a timesheet, but you know, you don't have the hours detail per day or per month. This is very important to bear in mind, because in fact, declaration of exclusive work for the action, for you know, some beneficiaries, they interpreted it. So if you have somebody somebody who doesn't work on other action, like their interpretation was that, you know, so they can use the declaration, but this is not correct, because the interpretation is that, or not interpretation, this is what written there, is that they don't need to have other activities, you know, so you need to be careful, you know, if there is evidence that they had lectures, unforeseen travel, writing proposals, or, you know, doing other stuff, you know, which may be not declared on another project, you know, so this is very important for you to bear in mind. Here, just to recap the procedures, you know, for the time recording system. So you see, probably you'll have meetings, walkthrough tests, you will review the documents, you will look at the formal criteria and this thing with the matching with the HR records. And also you need to bear in mind the evidence for the double sealing, which you also need to review. Bam, bam. This slide is very nice, because it's kind of giving you a flavor of, let's say, what it is in the menu, how the beneficiary can declare costs. So you see, they can use actual cost, average cost, and then, okay, for the SME owners, it's also kind of it's unit cost, but it's set up by the commission. Then if you use actual cost, you have the option between project-based remuneration and non-project-based. And the concept of additional remuneration, it exists only for project-based remuneration. And okay, this may be eligible or not, and there is also a cap to it. But in the most used case, like the non-project-based remuneration, there is the option to calculate monthly rates or annual rates. And then there are three options for the productive time: 17, 20 hours per year, individual productive time, and standard productive time. But okay, the individual productive time, you'll see it's not available if monthly rates are used. So which is the general and also the compulsory formula to calculate the hourly rates? So you have the hours worked, which are coming from the time records, multiplied by the hourly rate, which is okay based on these calculations that we will see. And then you can add on top the additional remuneration, but only if you are a non-for-profit organization. Here, okay, it's again listed the same thing. Bear in mind that it's not in the scope of the CFS, the SME owner without a salary, because those are flat rates set up by the Commission. Here it's explained how this is calculated, but as I said, it's not in your scope. This is not, is more just for your information, you know. But I kept it here because you may have a situation that you have an SME owner or a natural person which for some period they don't receive a salary, so then they use the unit cost, which is not in the scope of your CFS, but then they may switch to have a salary, and then you may, you know, still have SME owners or natural persons which are included in the CFS. About unit cost, so this is a very important topic, and here it's also something very interesting to mention, like when we do the comparison, let's say EC audits and CFS audits. So first about the unit cost. So why, what are these things, you know? So here the hourly rate is calculating according to the usual cost accounting practice, provided that, okay, we have these three big conditions. It is applied in a consistent manner based on objective criteria and regardless of the source of funding. It is calculated using the actual personal cost recorded in the accounts, excluding ineligible costs or included in other budget categories. It is used one of the options to determine the annual productive hours provided in the grant agreement. So this is the nice story. You will see that this approach is used not so often, mostly by very big beneficiaries, which they know what they are doing. But here, the key word is that you see this approach, it needs to be applied regardless of the source of funding. So this means that it should not be applied only for EU actions. And for EC audits, what the indicative audit program is saying that we need to pick up, you know, five projects, not EU projects, in which we need to check that the beneficiary used this unit cost also there, you know. But in the CFS, this is not included, but I just told you that as an aspiration. And in the CFS at the section A3 with the hourly rates, so it is said that if the beneficiary has a COMUC, then you kind of need to declare that they apply this unit cost in all the projects, so regardless the source of funding. But if they don't have a COMUC, the wording is relating only to the recalculation of the rates for the project that you are auditing. And then if you look at the first part, like in A1 with the personal cost and the part with unit cost, there it is mentioned that you know, they were applied consistency for Horizon 2020 project. So it appears there are, let's say, some differences here between the EC audits and the CFS. I would say it's normal because the scope and the usage of this is different. So let's see the next part. Now we have the formulas. How do we calculate the hourly rates in the general case or in the specific case with project-based remuneration? So you see in the general case, we have total personal cost divided by total productive hours. And then this rate is gonna be applied to all the projects that they are, you know, declaring cost for us. In the specific case, we look at the hours per action and also the personal cost only for that action. So you see, this is a very important step when you need to decide, are you in case 1A or 1B, like in the general or in the specific case. So then you may ask yourself, look, in which situation I am. And the answer, it's quite easy. So if the remuneration for time worked in some projects is different than the remuneration for other duties, then you are in the specific case. What does this mean is that, so when you see that the remuneration of a person is changing, if he's working in a project or not, it means that you are in the project-based remuneration. So how they can do this? So they may have supplementary employment contracts to work in a specific projects, a bonus or a premium for the time worked in a project, or that they would have a specific hourly rate, you know, for working in specific projects. Now we get back to the hourly rates calculation. So you see you have two options, like the annual calculation or the monthly calculation. The monthly calculation was introduced later in the program from 2016. Here it's a slide summarizing what they can include in the personal cost. So salaries and social charges of the employers and various taxes related to personal cost. And they need to exclude the ineligible items which we listed in part one of this training in the general procedures, and they also need to exclude costs included in other cost categories like indirect costs. And this is more important, especially for the average cost, for the unit cost, because there it may be that they also include some cost of indirect cost nature. It's more likely or probable. For the calculation of productive hours, there are three options. So we have the 1720, which is a new option compared to FP7. And this they must use it if the employment contract does not specify the working time or if the annual workable hours cannot be determined. Then they can also choose the individual annual productive hours. So here you have the annual workable hours and you add the overtime and the absences. And you have also the option of standard annual productive hours, which must be according to the beneficiary's usual accounting practices. And here there is, however, a minimum threshold. So the annual productive hours, they must be at least higher than 90% of the standard annual workable hours. So you need to bear in mind that even though the CFS, it's assuming that, okay, most beneficiaries, they only use one of the options for productive hours, that in fact, in reality, the beneficiary may do a mix of them, or they may use more options in the same time, but they need to make a differentiation in the sense that the same option must be applied to all personal working in Horizon 2020 actions, provided that you see that the same option is applied at least per group of personnel employed under similar conditions, like you see same staff category, cost center, same type of contract. And they also need to apply the options consistently, you know, so they cannot change it as they want, you know, depending if they get more money or not. And they need to keep the same options, the same approach for a financial year or a fiscal year, because, you know, the beneficiary, they can choose, okay, if they want to use the financial year or the fiscal year as the basis. So anyway, we'll talk more about this in the next slides. So if you look in the CFS, you will see that you have kind of option A, B, C, but in the grant agreement, we refer to option 1, 2, 3. So here you have the two types of wording. So here some comments about the productive hours. So the first one, the option A, doesn't need to be supported. It can just be used, you could say, for free. And it's in their favor if they do a pro rata when somebody is not working full time or the full year. Then for the individual annual productive hours, the formula is mandatory. So what does this mean? That they cannot, you know, deduct or add other things here in addition to the absences and overtime, you know, and this must be also supported. So it's not allowed to kind of do something, in fact, like the option C, but at the individual level. So this is not allowed for Horizon 2020. It's part of the simplification measures. So I guess that's maybe one of the reasons why we have sometimes these issues with the productive time. And then for the last option, the standard annual productive hour. So this must be calculated overall for the beneficiary or as explained here before, you see per staff category, type of contract, and cost center. As far as I have seen in the CFS, in the section about productive hours, which is, I think, A2, so it's not too much mentioned about the consistent application of the options for productive hours per staff category or type in all the actions in the same financial year, but this is something important and you need to bear in mind. I believe that was the case because the template, it's kind of, let's say, assuming that they will only use one option, so kind of that consistency it's ensured from the beginning. Then here it's a reminder that option two is not allowed for the monthly hourly rate, so that's very important because some beneficiaries, they did this mistake. And then for option three, the CFS procedures, they are telling you to verify the consistency with the usual cost accounting practice. In the EC audits, we are checking this by looking in 5 non-EU actions, but in the CFS, this is left at the discretion and at the professional judgment of the auditor. So, okay, bear this in mind. Here is a very nice slide summarizing how we calculate the hourly rates when the annual rates are used. So you see here that if in the reporting period you have a part of a calendar year or financial year which is not closed yet, so in this case the 3 months from 2021, so they need to use for that period the rate of 2020, which was closed. About the monthly rates, so as you would expect, you take the annual productive hours and you divide them by 12. It's not allowed for them to use option 2 for the productive time or option B. And if they have some bonuses or certain salaries and similar things, so they must be pro rata, you know, so they cannot include them in the month that they were paid in full amount. And then it's a very interesting point, this part with the time spent in parental leave, how can you deal with it? And if you want to see this, look in the annotated model grant agreement, because you find a very well explained example. So I will not spend time on this here in this presentation. So also in the CFS, in the third part about the rates, the hourly rates, you'll see that you need to check the consistency, you know, of application, that they, you know, that they kept the correct option in the same financial year of annual or monthly rates. But in the EC audits, we go a little bit further. So, okay, bear in mind this consistency because it's very important, even though maybe it's not so much emphasis of it in the CFS procedures. This is a very nice slide summarizing, you know, the differences you see below between basic remuneration and additional remuneration, and then when certain bonuses they are ineligible. And this slide, in fact, may explain why many beneficiaries, they did not, you know, tap into the additional remuneration, because even though they used project-based remuneration, so they didn't go, you know, you could say to the dark side and use the additional remuneration. Because you see, in order to be eligible, this needs to be used not just by EU action, you know. So many times this was quite possible to explain that, look, we have national projects, we pay this amount, and then we have other type of project which are not only EU actions, and here we pay more, you know. So this was not the reality, so then they didn't use this. But okay, we will go into more detail about project-based remuneration here. So here we have an example. You see somebody has a fixed salary contract, a family allowance, and then this is 100 euros per month. And then if they work in funded projects, they receive 1,000 euros more per month. So here it means that we are in project-based enumeration. Here are the steps, you know, how you need to do these calculations, also when you do your checks. But okay, you can read this, and anyway, we will see them better in the example. And by the way, also this approach was introduced from 2017, so before it was another definition for the additional remuneration. So with a new definition, additional remuneration means any part of the remuneration which exceeds what the person would be paid for time worked in projects funded by national schemes. And you can find in the grant agreement what it means, national schemes, in fact. And this is only eligible for non-profit legal entities. This slide is very important, and also I want to mention that in the CFS procedures, it is included that you need to check the consistency, you know, that they paid this additional remuneration, but basically it's nothing really linked to the base score of this eligibility criteria. Like you see, in order to be eligible, it needs to be paid at least once before the submission of the proposal to any employee, I would say any employee in that category, because many times you have some internal rules or laws, you know, which they explain this by type of staff, by category of staff. So additional remuneration may be explained in national law or internal rules, you know, so be sure that you check this thing. If these are not available, then there is a fallback option, which many times is not so interesting, but still it's better to have something. So then they can calculate the rates using the average of the salary of the person for the previous year, excluding remuneration and time worked for the Horizon 2020 action. So basically they are, let's say, trying to determine, you could say, an average rate they use for projects, but by cleaning them out of the Horizon 2020 action. So to kind of to see what they would pay, you know, in other actions, but not the Horizon 2020 actions. And this slide is summarizing how some internal rules should be set up in order for them to make this cost eligible. So the internal rules, they need to say who can get the extra remuneration, meaning which person or staff category, how much they will get, you know, in which conditions, like what has to happen for them to get the remuneration, like look to work in a project and so on. But bear in mind that it cannot apply only to EU actions. Now we have some examples of good or not so good internal rules. You see that, let's read this. The director may decide an extra payment for any member of staff participating in project. So this is not good because this is not an objective condition. And in this case, the extra remuneration would be not eligible. Then, in the other situation, any researcher participating in projects receiving external funds will get an extra remuneration of 20% of its salary. So this is good, but you need to be careful on one point, that if the extra remuneration is the same regardless of the number of hours worked in the project, then you would need to kind of do a pro rata, you know, to see. You see, to divide it by all the hours work by the person, project, and on project work to calculate which is the eligible part. Now let's see also some good examples. Like any professor participating in a research project in receiving external funds will get 10 euros extra per hour worked in the project. So here we know who will get how much and when, you know, so here we are all good. We do not have internal rules for the bonuses, but we always pay the same bonuses in same circumstances. So this is an example from real life. It happens many times, this type of reactions from the beneficiary. But if it's like that, you know, they should write it, you know, and it means that, you know, they should have some internal rules on this. So I hope that you will not see this situation too much. Now we have an example to better grasp these concepts. So you see we have Mr. T with basic salary, a fixed complement, and then you have these variable components depending on the participation in research projects, you know. And these are included in the internal rules of the entity. So she received 10,000 euros and she worked 800 hours in that action. They use 70-20 as productive hours and they use annual rates. So, okay. It's not the worst scenario, let's say. So let's see some calculations. But before, you see, we need to look in the internal rules and we also need to look, you know, how much the entity has paid in past for work in national projects. So here we add more information in the examples that let's assume that they may get up to 2,500 extra per month of full dedication. But you see, in reality, they only paid 1,433 per month, you know. So that's coming back, you know, to that slide that I said is very important, that it needs to be paid once before the submission of the project proposal. So here, if we do the math, we can see that, you know, that this person received more, so that's the action reference, 27.5, than the national reference. And the national reference is calculated based only on the amount actually paid. So you see, you have the two rates, and then it is this calculation showing how much is the additional remuneration. So now we need to see, so how much is the basic? So we apply the rate from the national projects to the hours declared. We obtain this amount. And then we need to see how much it's eligible as additional remuneration, because there is this cap of 8,000 euros per year of full-time equivalent, and this includes, you know, salary and all the taxes and social charges and so on. So you see here, if you are for profit, the additional remuneration is not eligible, so you just get the basic remuneration. But if you are a non-profit entity, then we need to look, okay, at the ceiling with the 8,000 per year, and also we need to see how much was actually paid, you see. So here we can see that not the full amount that was paid is eligible, you know. So here you see all the details of these calculations. This is the last slide of this part of the presentation. This is about the seconded personnel from third parties, okay, here against payment, but they may be also provided for free. And this slide is summarizing kind of the main things that you will need to check in order to perform the procedures from the CFS. So you will, you know, review the secondment contracts or other equivalent documentations like decision, engagement letters, and so on. And you will need to see that the seconded personnel worked for the beneficiary and in what conditions. And special attention must be made to the clause that persons are at the disposal of the beneficiary. Okay, so this is part two of this presentation. I hope it was clear. This is your host, Gheorghe Bancos, looking forward to see you in part three of this presentation, dealing with subcontracting and other direct costs.